Hi, and welcome to the Theme Park Duo Podcast. Grab your park map, Chiro, and hop in line with us as we take you on a coast-to-coast adventure through the world of theme parks, haunts, conventions, and more. Now, here's your hosts, Nikki and Gabriel.
Hello, everybody, and welcome back to the Theme Park Duo Podcast for Season 3. I'm Gabe.
And I'm Nikki.
And we are
the Theme Park Duo.
It feels good to be back, finally.
Yeah, Season 3.
I feel like The Rock. This is going to be a wrestling reference. Finally, The Rock has come back to Los Angeles. That's a wrestling reference that you probably won't understand at all. And a lot of our audience probably will not understand. But that's fine. It's a reference for myself anyway.
Okay.
You're like, just move it along.
Yeah.
We're in episode 1 of season 3.
We're not a wrestling show.
We have a long road to go here. Let's keep moving. Okay. I get the message.
Yeah. But yeah, season 3.
Which is nice.
That's an accomplishment.
We are no longer sophomoric. We have moved on to our junior year.
Uh-huh.
Which is nice.
So that means technically we're supposed to get better.
Right? Oh. I don't know if necessarily better. Just more of it.
Yeah. More of the same, people. You're welcome.
Hopefully fun stuff that you enjoy. And we do have some fun episodes planned and lined up for season 3. Speaking of which, our opening episode, our season 3 season premiere, is an interview with Rolly Crump, a very famous Imagineer, Disney legend, a designer of all sorts of things.
And great guy.
Yeah. That was actually supposed to be our season finale.
Yeah, but we had a little timing issue with chatting with him. So
the tiny thing just didn't work out, and then we ended up, you know, obviously need to switch things up and make things work, which I actually think that our episode with Rick worked out great, which you guys should go listen to that. You know, Rick is always an amazing person to talk with, and he always gives really great perspectives, but I'm just glad in general that we got to sit down with Rolly and chat about, you know, some of his Disney history, and particularly with Walt Disney, which is kind of insane.
Heads up, words of warning, I disappear from the interview. The baby woke up from her nap.
You did not see anything. Nikki just disappears.
Suddenly I'm just not there. I don't know. You may not miss me at all. So.
When it comes to these kind of interviews, I kind of like just letting the guests talk. So it's not like I'm talking a bunch either.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's not like, you know, there's a lot of Gabe and Nikki banter anyway. So, you know, it was a great interview. Whether I was there or not. And I enjoyed listening to it after.
There you go.
Just like everybody else.
Yes. And in between season 2 and 3, obviously, we had the baby. Everybody knew about that happening.
Well, we had the baby. Yeah, we had the baby during season 2. So the last few episodes, the baby was here.
So the baby is now a little older, a little wiser, off to college, doing her thing. She's got her first job already. She's working at Subway as a sandwich artist. No. Obviously, Aaron is like 4.5 months. Very little still. But we're getting our sleep as of right now. So that's kind of nice.
Yeah, you just jinxed us.
Huh?
You just jinxed us.
No, I didn't jinx us. We talk about this all the time. We constantly talk about this.
I feel jinxed.
That's not my fault.
I feel if we get very little sleep this next week coming up, it's your fault, and I will tattle on you and tell people on the show.
That is fine. We'll bring it up on the next show.
Okay.
Bring it up. I don't care.
Okay.
You'll see. You're gonna be so well rested that you're gonna remember that.
You're gonna if I'm right, you're the one waking up and taking care of her.
That is fine with me.
Okay.
Because I do it anyway.
We both switch off.
Switch off.
Okay. Back on track.
Yeah, we get off track very quickly here. Anyway, if you could hear the strain in our voices, it's because we literally just walked through the door from a trip to Disney California Adventure.
Our first trip this year.
Mm-hmm.
And
no baby, by the way.
Yeah, no baby. We went to a wedding in Orange County. We took the opportunity to go to Disney California Adventure. So we had a great time, and Erin is very happy at her grandma's house.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. So, that's why you might hear a little little strain in our voices.
Yeah.
But it's because we had a blast.
We had a great time. And it's the first time in over a year that I've been there not pregnant. So I finally got to go on the Incredicoaster. I got to go on Guardians again after so long. So I had a really good day.
Everything turned out really great. We did Guardians four times. We did Incredicoaster twice. We literally did everything in the park.
Uh-huh.
Except for Frozen, because we've seen Frozen plenty of times.
Highlight of the day, you got a new ranking in Midway Mania.
It was like second to the top. What is it? It's
fox or something.
So rabbit, fox.
Second from the top. Yeah, your score was like 221,000. So
yeah,
that's
I was the leader in our vehicle.
Yes, you so usually are anyway, floor. But never that high before.
I'm usually like one below.
Yeah,
I'm never actually top leader scorer.
Yeah.
In the vehicle, I'm usually one below.
Yeah,
but we both did it pretty okay. You did better than you thought you would have done.
Yeah, I said it like halfway through. I was like, oh man, I'm phoning it in. Like I just really didn't care. Like sometimes your arm gets tired, you know, pulling the little thingamajig.
The string.
Yeah, your arm gets tired. So like halfway through, I was like, oh man, I don't care enough to do this. So I just phoned it in. I just kind of, my hand was just lying there and I was just, you know, pulling it with my elbow resting. But hey, bit. I did all right. I got over 100,000.
I was going to say, you playing this game is very much like the scene from Predator, where all of them are just in the forest, just shooting their guns into the open forest, not aiming at anything. They're just, yeah!
That's me with any game I have ever played.
Any
ever.
Shooting game, you're just like spraying bullets everywhere.
Yes.
There's that saying again. Anyway, we digress. Uh-huh. We had a good trip to Disney, and we look forward to a few more trips there and some other trips to other theme parks that I'm sure you'll be hearing about on the show.
Yeah.
So, without further ado, let's jump right into our interview with Rolly Crump. Hello, everybody. So, welcome to the interview that we're going to be having here. As you heard in the intro, we have someone very special on the show today. We have somebody who's a legend in the themed entertainment industry, working on projects such as It's a Small World, Haunted Mansion, Tiki Room, Knott's Berry Tales, Astro World, and even animation with Peter Pan, 101 Dalmatians, Lady and the Tramp, and Sleeping Beauty. We have the incomparable Rolly Crump on the show today. Welcome, sir.
Welcome.
Okay, thank you.
So, I know that you've had a long history in the themed entertainment industry, working with Walt Disney, working over at Knott's Berry Farm, and, you know, there's a lot of different projects that you've worked on, and it's hard to talk about everything without doing a 3-hour, 4-hour show. So we'll try to do our best to touch upon the greatest works, as it were.
Okay, sounds good.
So I know that you started in animation in 1952 at Disney, and you worked on some of those early movies that they had there. How did you land in animation first?
Well, first of all, I always wanted to work with Disney, and I didn't know even what animation was. I just thought I wanted to work with Disney and be an artist. And so what happened was I went in for an interview and met with them and everything. And I took my portfolio in, which was pretty much my high school portfolio, which was kind of embarrassing for me even then. But anyway, they said, well, we'll look at your resume and then you come back in a week or so and we'll let you know. So I was thrilled and scared to death. And then they called and they had me come in, and they said, well, we'll offer you a job. And I said, oh, my God. So I was shocked. And then they started going through the list of things that I had or would do. And then the next day they told me that they would start me at $30 a week. And I'm sitting there saying, Jesus Christ, $30 a week? And I've got a family that I'm raising and a new house I bought. And I thought, oh, my God, I can't afford to go to work for Disney. And so when I went home that night, my mom has been my best rep and following, having me follow through on things. So I said, what do you think, Mom? And she said, take the job. She said, it'll all work out. So when I went back they asked me about it 2 weeks later. I went back and they said, well, I said, yeah, I'll take the job. That's no problem. So anyway, they said, okay, fine. So they've hired me. And what happened was the reason that I could go back and was able to supplement this was I had a friend that built sewer manholes. And he told me he'd hire me on weekends, Saturday and Sunday, to help him build sewer manholes. So my claim to fame is I helped build sewer manholes so I could work at Disney. And that was great. It worked on for quite some time. And so that's the start.
So the lesson of the story is always listen to your mom, right?
Yes, that's true. Yeah, my mom was really a sweetheart. She's so way ahead. I think she was a psychic.
I think most moms are.
Yeah, you're right.
So how long did you work in animation?
Oh, 8 years. I stayed in animation until they invited me to go to WED. But and that's another kind of a kid story. If you went to work for WED after being in animation, you joined Cannibal Island because nobody heard from you again. Which I thought was kind of a cute little metaphor.
That's interesting. So when you left for WED, what did they see in you that they wanted?
Well, it's because Walt saw my propellers. What happened was I had an exhibit in the library of my artwork and propellers and mobiles, and I found out through the grapevine, through the gal that ran the gallery, that Walt came and saw my stuff. And I said, oh my God. And one hallway I had was all my dope posters. And I said, did he go down the hallway? And she said, yes. And I said, did he read the posters? And she said, yes. I said, what did he say? She said, he laughed. Walt laughed at my marijuana poster. So I thought, oh shit, that he's cool. Anyway, that's how that all got started. And when they hired me, they didn't have a clue what to do with me. I think what happened was Walt saw my imagination and my creativity. So I was hired on that basis, I think, more than anything else.
I'd say that sounds like an incredible compliment to you and your work. If, you know, yeah, they didn't necessarily have a spot for you, but they said, we see so much potential in what you do that we want you regardless of what is happening.
Yeah.
I know that you said they didn't have a project for you to work on at that time, but what was the first project that you worked on when you did transfer from animation to WED?
Okay, well, first of all, they were going to do a little, a ride, Alice in Wonderland.
Alice in Wonderland.
And so the first project I had, because of my propellers, they wanted me to design and build a field of flowers that were spinning. So that's what I did. My first job was to make a whole bunch of flowers that were spinning flowers. And so I did that. And I thought, Jesus Christ, is this what I'm going to do for a living? It was really kind of weird. But that never took place because Walt decided not to do that particular story.
So what was your first big project that you got to work on there?
I'm trying to think of what the one was that followed after that. I know what it was. That's when I did the bazaar. So what happened was Dick Irvine said, well, Wally, we're going to give you a chance of being an art director. And I said, okay. And they said, there's a bazaar in Adventureland that is really kind of crummy and lousy, and we'd like to have you redesign it and rebuild it. So I did. So in 6 weeks, they sent me over to Allied Studios, which they rented a soundstage for me to build this everything to go in there. And what happened was, it was another kind of a cute story. I think Dick Irvine didn't believe that I'd be able to do it. I mean, for some reason, I guess maybe because I was so much younger. So he basically, what he did, he lied to me about the opening day. And
oh, geez.
I found out through the grapevine later that he lied to me. And then I realized that opening date that I had was extremely important for me. So that's really what happened. So I actually met my obligation on having everything ready on that date. And I called down, I called Dick Irvine and told him, well, we're going to ship everything that we built tomorrow morning, which is going to be Saturday morning. And Dick says, what? And he was shocked. He didn't know that I finished on time. And he says, well, I think, and he starts stuttering a little bit. and he had to call Joel Fowler, who was running Disneyland, and tell him that I was delivering all the set pieces on Saturday. and then Joel Fowler and let him know that there wasn't even a floor in the building.
Oh, jeez.
Oh, my God.
So Dick says, well, what do we have to do? And he says, we've got to meet that schedule. And so he was kind of caught in a hot spot. And so they actually had the people come in to build, put the floor in, and it took them 2 nights. They worked all night long, 2 nights in a row, to get my floor in so I'd be in there on time. So I kind of had a big smile on my face about that one because I kind of nailed them. And you know what's really interesting? I didn't realize that there was so much crap that went on that you didn't know about. I didn't realize that they would lie to me. I thought, why are they lying to me? And so I learned in a hurry of what it was really like to get involved with projects with them. And the interesting thing about it is some of the guys were right on top of everything and great. Some of the other guys weren't quite sure what they were doing. So anyway, that was kind of a fun one. I enjoyed that one. So, and I'm very proud of the bazaar. It really turned out beautifully.
When you got projects there, I know that, you know, Marty Sklar has mentioned this, and so has Bob Gurr. They mentioned, you know, the blank piece of paper that they're faced with when needing to create something. Are you the type of person that gets really excited to see that blank piece of paper and to create something completely from scratch, like the bazaar or any of the other attractions that you've built?
I love the challenge. I always love the challenge of doing something I've never done before, because I just believed in that it could be done. And I learned some formulas from John Hinch about how to attack these projects. And so I was thrilled. I couldn't wait for him to give me projects.
Looking back, what was your biggest challenge that you can remember in a project?
That's a hard one to answer because they were all big challenges. I guess the biggest one of all was to design Small World for the World's Fair. And that really was a challenge because we designed and built it in... I think it was 9 months. Yeah, 9 months. And to design it and build it. And when you build it, we built it and put it in a soundstage so Walt would see it before we shipped it to New York. So we really were under a lot of pressure, because then once it was finished and was put in the soundstage for Walt to review, then it was repacked up and then sent to the World's Fair. And then I would meet with Walt at the World's Fair and walk him through it, which was kind of exciting. And that was the most exciting thing I could do, was to have the old man at my side as we walked through projects together.
How did you know when he approved of something? Was there something that Walt would say or do or act when he was extremely happy with your work?
No, he didn't say anything. He just gave me another job. I told everybody that. I said, as long as you get another job, he must like what you did. And, you know, there was some little secrets that went on that I thought were real special. When I did the bazaar, it was a shop, you know, a little shop. And the fellow that I worked with was Jack Olson, who was the head of merchandise at Disneyland. And he was very talented. He was an art designer himself. But he'd done a lot of the shops at Disneyland. And one of the shops that he did, and now this again is a kid's story, was the candle shop on Main Street. It was this little tiny building that was where they sold the candles. What he did was he filled that whole room with mirrors. So when you walked in there, that had all the candles hanging from the ceiling, they looked like they went on forever. And so he taught me that little trick of using mirrors. So when we did the bazaar, he helped me put all these mirrors in the bazaar. Well, the coup de grace on that one was that Walt came down to see me the night that the bazaar opened up, and he brought his wife Lily with him. And of course, I'd been working in the field for about 3 or 4 days and hadn't been home to take a shower or anything else. And so all of a sudden he says, well, Lisa, I want you to meet my wife, Lily. And I held out my hand to shake her hand. And of course, you know, it wasn't real spiffy clean. And she looked at me like, do I have to shake his hand? But she was such a sweetheart. She reached over and grabbed my hand and shook it. Anyway, we were sitting there, the three of us, and Walt loved the mirrors. And he kept saying to her, he says, Lily, look at this shop goes on forever. And so he was thrilled with the mirrors. And so here I used Jack Olson's secret to sell Walt on the mirrors. And I should have told Walt, that wasn't my idea. That was Jack Olson's. But I did all that at a later date, giving somebody else credit.
After you got another job, right?
Yeah, that's exactly how I got another job. And you know, the funny part about it is, as the years went on with all the job, you know, Dick Gertwein would come and call me and give me an assignment. And I found out through Hanch that he didn't give me the assignment. Walt did. Walt actually gave me all the assignments that I was ever given when I was working for the studio or for Disneyland. And I always thought it was Dick Gertwein, but no, Walt would tell Dick what to tell me to do.
Oh.
When you...
I thought that was kind of special.
When you found that out, were you kind of shocked?
Yes, I was shocked. But the biggest shock of all, now this is an incredible shock. Evidently, to prove that the old man kind of went along with me and liked my stuff, after he had passed away, and we were having an open house down at the 33 Club for lunch, Roy Disney was there, and I'd never met Roy. And Roy walked up to me and said, "Are you Rolly Crump?" And I said, "Yes, I am." He said, "Well, my brother used to talk about you." And I said, "Jesus Christ, what a thank you that can be."
Goodness gracious.
That made me feel awfully good.
Pulling at our heartstrings.
That Roy ever and I ever, the conversation we had was that long, and we never talked again, which is kind of wild. But there was something that John had taught me about how to put packages together. And evidently he had, because he had worked for Walt for quite some time, so he knew exactly how to present, how to do a presentation with Walt. So he really helped me. So I had so much help from a lot of people that were in the company.
Mm-hmm.
And then it showed that the old man really did like my stuff. So there. In fact, I did find out later in a meeting, there was a fellow that was a lawyer that was in a meeting, and he and I were pretty close, and it was a meeting with Walt. And he says, "You know, Rolly, Walt said the other day that they were talking about wedding, and Walt said, the only guy that's any good at all at wedding is Rolly Crump." So that was a shocker, too. But it all came in backwards, and that was okay. As long as I heard that story eventually from people that were around, Walt made me feel awfully good.
Yeah. What do you think Walt saw in you that, you know, he took to you so much?
Oh, yeah. I think what he saw in me was I always would show him something he'd never seen before. And I know I sat in meetings with him for almost 2 years before I said a word, just studying the other guys and how they reacted on the meetings that we had. And through that, you know, being observant, I could see the things that would spark to him were things that he'd never seen before. So I said to myself, if you're going to do something to show it to him, you better show him something he's never seen before. And I think a good example of that was the Museum of the Weird.
Oh.
That's a prize example of it, so...
Well, I have a question of that a little later down the line in my list here. So we'll get to the Museum of the Weird because I'm very, very much interested in that. When it comes to projects Walt would give you, like the Tiki Room, when he decided, hey, let's change this from a restaurant to a full show with what we know as audio animatronics, what was your thought when he said that? Did you think it was crazy? Did you think it was insane? Did you think it would work?
No, I was excited. You know, what Walt did, he always would take us to the next level. In other words, and that's something that I learned a long time ago about taking it to the next level. Because when I was doing magic as a hobby, I'd always do my card tricks and I'd always take them to the next level. So taking things to the next level was something I absolutely loved and enjoyed. And then sitting there with Walt, see, a lot of people don't realize that Walt really was behind us on the design of things at Disneyland. They just thought, oh, well, he's Walt Disney, and he kind of comes around once in a while. He would give you a little key thing to do that would take that project into another level, and I always loved that. So I always was looking forward to the next level I would be doing with Walt.
So it sounds like he would implement these upgrades, but also not impede on your creativity. And do you think that's where Walt succeeded when, you know, building Disneyland with you and everyone else?
No, never. No. He'd help me. I mean, it was kind of cute. We were doing a walkthrough of the small world when it was in the sound stage. And Walt was really good about, you know, checking in on stuff. And he said, "Well, Rolly, there's a holiday there." And I said, what the hell's a holiday? And he says, well, it's something that's blank in a set. He says, it's a term that's used in the film industry. A holiday means that there's something missing that should be there. And so I said, oh. He said, yeah, look at there. He says, there's nothing up in the ceiling there. And I said, well, I can put a balloon up there. And he says, great. That'll solve the problem. But that was it. That was so beautiful out working with him. You'd actually have a conversation. I did anyway, and talked to him. And he knew that I was just a young kid, and he went along with my being a little naive. So he was really kind of helping me along the way, which was really beautiful. We had an incredible relationship. It was absolutely marvelous.
It sounds like Walt was a really good collaborator as much as he was an innovator.
Yes. Well, you know, I can give you examples of how he would take something and make it much better. And I think one of the examples was the clock in front of Small World. There was a big space there when we were finishing up Small World facade, and there was a platform. And Walt said to me, he said, what are you going to put on that platform, Rolly? And I said, Jesus, I don't know. I said, maybe we'll have an orchestra come up there and play. He said, no, we're not going to have any orchestra going up there and playing. And he was really kind, because he was very direct with me. He said, why don't we put a clock there? And I said, oh, a clock. So I immediately called Mary Blair, and I said, would you do me a sketch of what a Small World clock would look like? And she did. She sent it on a little kind of a napkin piece of paper. And I took that, and I built a model from it. And I showed it to Walt. Walt said, good, let's go with it. And then what happened was they wanted me to just actually build, because Walt loved models. They decided they wanted the model to actually animate. And so I got this real young guy that was really kind of a genius in doing design, in mechanical things. So he and I built the first the model of the clock, and I mean the first clock model, excuse me, and built a model on it to actually worked. It wasn't just a hard model, it actually, the doors opened up and closed and everything. So he and I worked on that together, and it was really beautiful. And so one day, my friend Dick Irvine, said, Walt's coming over to look at the clock. And then he said, by the way, he says, I don't like the clock. And he was, you know, he was come from the old school. He says, you know, the clock should have been more European looking. And I said, well, are we changing it? And he says, no. He says, I was thinking of having Mark Davis redesign it. And I said, oh, all right, but can we show it to Walt first? He says, yeah. And I think he didn't realize that Walt came by on a daily basis and talked with me, and we worked together as a team on this. So anyway, I actually have a photograph of Walt and I looking at the model, actually animating that very day. And Walt and I are both looking at it and laughing, and I got a copy of it, which is beautiful. Well, when it was over with and Walt had seen it, Dick Irvine came up, he says, well, Walt, he says, you know, I don't think it has that European quality to it, so I'm going to put Mark Davis in charge of it. And Walt looked him straight in the eye and said, no, I like it the way it is. And I said, well, don't fuck with me, Walt. Don't fuck with me, Dick Irvine. Well, I don't know, Dick, I mean, Walt and I had some sort of a nice little connection, because I was so honest with him. That's the one thing that I learned was, don't ever lie to him, be honest with him, and tell him exactly how you feel.
Yeah.
If he disagrees with you, then you take it from there. So
yeah.
I think that was the relationship that Walt and I had, that he trusted me to always speak out and tell him what I believe. And I think the example of it is the first time I took him down to see the Tower of the Four Winds. And I was really upset about the way it turned out, because it looked like it had been over-engineered. And Walt, we were and I standing there looking at it. Walt says, what do you think of it? I said, I think it's a piece of crap. He says, well, it can't be a piece of crap. It cost me $400,000.
Jeez.
Walt was so sweet to me, because he says, Rolly, he says, you have to understand engineering. He said, the guys over designed it was because the wind loads in New York are pretty heavy. And he said, they have to make sure that damn thing doesn't blow down. And I said, oh, okay. So I was learning as I went.
Is that the reason why I didn't make it to Disneyland?
No. There's a political reason for why it didn't come back. And Walt was upset about it not coming back. Vice presidents called me in one day. And there was five of them. And they said, you know, Walt wants to bring the Tower of the Four Winds back. And they said, we don't want him to, but we don't want to bring it back. And so the fellow that was the head of finances, really, it's a budget that's pretty high, that we don't want to spend that kind of money to bring it back. One of the engineers said, you know, there's chances that some of those propellers could blow off and it might hit somebody and kill them.
Uh-oh.
So, and then they said the maintenance on it is going to be horrible. So these vice presidents are telling Lady Dunroley why they don't want it to come back. And I said, well, I agree with you. I don't like it. I don't want it to bring back in anyway. And they said, yeah, but we want you to tell Walt. So it was my job to tell Walt that I didn't want to bring it back. So what happened was, when we had the meeting with Walt, and they said they didn't want to bring it back, then Walt turned to each one of them and said, especially the financial guy, said, are you worried about the cost of this? And of course the financial guy said, well, yes, but you know, it's okay. You know, so he would kind of backtrack a little bit. So he went through all for the vice presidents, asking them the question of why they didn't want to bring it back, and he knew damn good and well what they were going to say. So he had it pretty much clear in his head that Rolly has been aware of a lot of this. So he said, well, what do you think, Rolly? I said, I don't want to bring it back. He said, okay, we won't bring it back. And boy, they were out of that office in 2 seconds after that meeting.
That's interesting.
But none of them ever came back and thanked me.
Oh, no.
You know, but anyway, that's kind of, you know, that's another cute story.
Moving attractions to another famous attraction that you worked on, the Haunted Mansion. How did the creative process for that attraction start?
Walt always wanted a haunted mansion. He wanted a haunted house in Disneyland, and that's where it all started. And what happened was, one of the architects actually designed the haunted mansion, and they built it. And of course, the haunted mansion illusions were not in the park; they were out of the park. It actually went underneath the trail, the railroad tracks, and walked into a huge sound stage that was the mansion.
You could easily say that is the greatest illusion of the Haunted Mansion, is the fact that you feel as though you're walking into this plantation-style home, and it's massive on the inside, much more big than you thought it would be.
Oh, yeah. They couldn't believe it. Yeah, and after they got out of the ride and they looked back at the building, they said, all that shit couldn't have been in that little dinky building.
Could you talk about the Museum of the Weird a little bit?
This, again, is a project that Rolly Crump and John and Walt Disney designed together. I always was very concerned with the direction the mansion was taking, right? Some of the sketches that were done by some of the artists, because it wasn't scary.
Yeah.
It was kind of the same old haunted house. And so I always thought, you know, we really got to get some weird stuff in there. Well, I had seen a film that was made in Paris. It was a French film. It was, I don't know, probably in the 40s. And I used to go to all the theaters and I would see different foreign films. And there was this monster of Beauty and the Beast was the name of the film, and it showed where the beast lived, and he lived in a castle, and then when you went to the castle with him, arms on the wall would hold the torches and lean forward to show people where to walk, and then there would be a bowl of grapes on the table, and the hand that was holding would reach out to have someone take one, and then we had sculpted heads with steam coming out of their mouths and were to the right and left of the fireplace. And I thought, Jesus, this stuff is great. So what happened was I started doing sketches on my own, kind of along those lines, to do things that had never been done before. I designed the Candle Man. And so I know that the Candle Man was one of the first things he saw. And I knew that he was going to see stuff he'd never seen before. But anyway, what happened was everybody didn't like him. And so when we had the meeting, the presentation, all the designers had presentations of Walt about the mansion. And I had all my stuff on a table, and Dick Irvine made sure that table was not facing Walt's table. Now, really, I mean, this was kind of sad. I got to understand, you know, how some of this stuff works. Finally, Walt to Dick Irvine, he said, was that it? And Dick says, yeah, that's it. He says, well, what's that stuff that's over there on that table? And he says, well, that's some of Rolly stuff. He says, well, what's Rolly stuff? He says, we don't know. You ask him. So Walt did. He and I scooted our table, our chairs over to the table. And he says, well, what's this for? And I said, I don't know. And because, again, being honest, I don't know. I said, I just feel that the mansion is not scary enough and we need some strange things in there to make it feel like there's some really weird stuff going on in there. And he said, weird stuff going on in there? I said, yeah. I said, I think that's what it should be. So we, the meeting went on for maybe another 10 minutes. He kept saying, Rolly, and I said, you all? And we kept passing this back and forth and we weren't going anywhere with it. So finally, Walt says, I'm going home. He said, I'll talk to you guys later. And when he walked out, all the guys in that meeting came up to me and said, we told you Walt wouldn't like that. It was too weird for us, not for Disneyland. So he said, too bad, Rolly. And I said, well, I don't know. I said, I had a good time, and I enjoyed doing it, and I really believe in it. So the next morning, I came to work at 7 o'clock in the morning. Walt Disney sitting in my chair at my desk at 7 o'clock in the morning. And I said, good morning. He said, you son of a bitch. He said, you son of a bitch. He says, I didn't get any sleep last night. And I said, you didn't? He said, no. He said, all that stuff you showed me yesterday, kept me awake all night thinking about it. He says, but I have an answer to it. I says, you do? And I says, what is it? He says, we're going to do a museum. We're going to do a museum of the weird. And he says, Rolly, you can do the weirdest stuff in the world that you want to do, and we'll put it in the museum of the weird. I said, oh, shit, Walt, that's a pretty good idea. So anyway, a few minutes later, Dick Irvine showed up. He came in kind of late that morning, and he was had a couple cups of coffee in his hand looking for Walt, going for Walt, but Walt came to work before he did. And so anyway, Walt called all the guys in, and he gave him a half-hour presentation on what the museum of the weird would be like. And they, oh, God, they just thought that was great. So once it was over with, he said, well, I'm going to go home and go to bed. And they all said, okay. And so when he left, they, God, they, you know, oh, my God, Nolan, what a great idea you had. You know, they kissed my ass. You couldn't believe it. You know, and I knew this was a way. I didn't realize this in the very beginning that it was going to be this kind of crap you had put up with some of your co-employees. So anyway, that's how it all got started.
Yeah, you had to deal with egos.
Oh, yeah, egos, yeah. Well, jealousy.
Yeah.
A lot of jealousy. That was the thing. I didn't know there was jealousy until I had to live with it. And then I thought, oh, my God, there is jealousy. So I learned that when I was in animation. There was a lot of jealousy in animation. Everybody was jealous of Mary Blair. And so there's a lot of stories that went on. And then I thought, Jesus Christ, this place is like any place else, I guess, with all the crap that goes on. But the old man always was there. He was something else. He always made something 10 times better than it was to begin with, just by being there and being able to make some suggestions.
And Walt passed away before the Haunted Mansion opened, correct?
Yeah, right, exactly.
Yeah, and how was the process of finishing the mansion after Walt passed away? How difficult was it?
I wasn't involved. They took me off of it. After Walt passed away, Dick Irvine didn't want me to get involved with the mansion at all. So he gave me a different assignment.
Hmm.
And I thought, oh, okay, fine. So all the stuff I did, I thought, well, that's part of the name of the game. But the one thing that came out of it, bottom line is, if you really look at the mansion and why it is so goddamn likable, is the fact of the illusions. Yale Gracie did all the illusions for the Haunted Mansion. If you took the illusions out of the Haunted Mansion, it'd be really dry as toast.
I mean,
it would really be a dumb thing to go through. But his little, the talking head in the ball, Pepper's ghosts going around the table and everything, everything that he came up with and put in, and nobody knew what to do with him because he'd been given, he and I were given the excitement for 3 years to work on the Haunted Mansion. So everything that Yale wanted to do, I would build the models for him to show Walt what his ideas were. So again, if it hadn't been for Yale Gracie, the mansion would have been just dumb.
Yeah.
So anyway, I'm thrilled, and I keep telling everybody about how important he was, and if it wasn't for him, we wouldn't have a mansion. I keep kind of letting everybody know that he was the man behind this that made that ride what it was.
Yeah, I remember watching a special that came out a long time ago, but when I was little, it was a special that I had seen on TV with you and Yael Gracie showing Walt, you know, the stretching portraits and the changing portraits, and, you know, watching you at a young age, or at least you at a young age, but also me at a young age, watching you show Walt that stuff had made a big impression on me as a young kid, and wanting to get into art and film and that kind of a thing, and, you know, being able to create something that's so imaginative and have it become iconic really moved me.
Oh my God, that's great.
Moving on, finishing up your work at Disneyland here, what would you say is the one project you're most proud of that's at Disneyland?
Well, I know I get that question all the time. You have to look at it, and you had to be there. I was proud of everything I did, including the trash cans. I don't know, there's just something inside of me that loved everything I did, and I never put anything too high on the scale, because it was all just a delight to be involved with. I think that what happens is that you have to look back on what is something that you did that was more you than anybody else. And meaning that, you know, it wasn't teamwork, it was just rolling. And that's kind of an egotistical way to look at it. But there were some things that I did that only I did, and that was the clock for Small World and what I went through to get that done. I think that was one of my special things that I loved. The Tower of the Four Winds by far was the best thing I ever did. That I didn't get the support from the people that would have kept it, that brought it to Disneyland. If every one of those vice presidents said, "Rolly, we'll help you do this, and we'll help you every way so we can bring it back," not one of them said they'd help me. They all wanted to get rid of it. So, I mean, all they did was looking like, "Oh, well, we're going to have to work a little harder if we bring that to Disneyland." So I think the Tower of the Four Winds was definitely my design, nobody else's, because I built the model out of my head. And then the other thing was, of course, the clock. So I'm very proud of those two pieces. I can remember the day that we were going to talk about the Tiki Room. There was only three of us in the room with Walt when that idea came up. And when you stop and think about four people in a room coming up with it was something very, very special.
I think there's something to be said about the work that you've done at Disneyland, especially when now you're looking at products that they're creating where they're recreating your trash cans as salt and pepper shakers, as ornaments, recreating the front of Small World as like little standees for people's desks, or even new carvings of the tiki gods in the front of the tiki room. So, you know, clearly the work that you've done there has stood the test of time.
Oh, yeah. I don't know. I didn't know that.
I have those.
I do know that they copied my little sketches that I did that were going to be man-eating plants, and they made wallpaper designs out of that.
That's cool.
It was kind of a crack up because people would contact me and say, "God, we really like the wallpaper design you did for the match." I said, "What wallpaper design?" I didn't know anything about it. What happened was Claude Coates, the designer of it, had seen my sketches and used them and wanted to make wallpaper out of them. So, yeah, this is weird.
Well, even then, still, you know, your work even inspires the other people that worked at Disney with you. So that's really, really cool.
I loved everybody I worked with. It was really great. Of course, Dick Irvine was kind of my exception. We kind of laugh about that. There's a friend of mine that signed my book, John Horney, and he wrote in there, "I'm glad I'm not Dick Irvine." But he signed my book. I thought that was funny.
That's funny. So Walt went on record saying that he never wanted his park to become a museum. You know, he never wanted the things to become stale. How do you feel about having attractions like Tiki Room and Small World and Haunted Mansion and Pirates still there, you know, not necessarily being changed dramatically, but changed enough to still stay there? Do you think that it's important to leave those rides at Disneyland so that they could stand as a testament to what Walt Disney has created? Or do you think that we should stay with Walt's initial idea of not letting things become a museum, and, you know, would you be okay with them taking them out?
Yeah, I think it should stay under the umbrella that it was designed for. You know, there were so many films and things that Walt did that none of that was used in Disneyland at all. And there's some great stories and great rides that could be designed. And, you know, instead of having to go and bring rides from the other theme, I mean, the other films, you know, what's his name? One ride that they played in. Yeah.
Johnny Depp.
Yeah, yeah. Well, no, that was okay. That was an addition. I'm thinking of Star Wars.
Oh, yeah.
I don't think, that whole thing about Star Wars and Disneyland, I think is wrong. I disagree with that completely. I think that you stay within a theme.
When it comes to the theme park industry as a whole today, what do you think about the way that they're taking the industry when it comes to intellectual properties like Star Wars or like Harry Potter and things like that? Or do you think and believe that we should still be creating these incredible, unique ideas like a tiki room or a haunted mansion?
Yes, I think there should be more creativity. I think if you really put the right, you know, I had teams of people that I worked with at WED that were just absolutely incredible. Absolutely incredible. I love these guys and what they did. And I think that if we get the right teams together, you can come up with some gorgeous stuff. But I don't know, there's something about creativity that kind of falls apart sometimes if you don't have the right leadership.
Mm-hmm. Well, first off, I have to say thank you so much for taking the time to talk to us about all the incredible work you've done at Disney. And I know that we've talked about possibly doing a sequel, a part two, where we're going to be talking about Design 27 as well as Knott's Berry Tales, which is another incredible attraction that you helped design. So thank you so much.
Okay, great. Thank you for talking to me.
Of course. I mean, I'm always interested in hearing the stories from the people that helped, you know, shape and really impressed me when I was really young. And having the moment to actually speak with you and talk with you about your experiences is incredible for me. So I really, really appreciate it. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.
Hearing firsthand accounts of working with Walt Disney and just the design process of a lot of these attractions that you and I grew up with and attractions that are really considered iconic is a really special opportunity.
It's honestly, it's priceless because, you know, pretty soon we're not going to have the ability to do that because no one will be around that worked with Walt. So, you know, we have to cherish these people and these stories while we can, and, you know, get them down recorded so that we have them in years to come. So
I mean, it's very much what, like, we were talking about
it's
with Rick
said, yeah,
at the very end of season two, is, you know, it's important to have these stories correctly down so that they could last the test of time.
Mm-hmm.
And for us to having had the chance to sit down with Rolly and get these stories and hear them and being able to, you know, tell other people these stories is pretty incredible. And I'm really thankful that we actually had the chance to Rolly. And I would like to thank Rolly very much for letting us have the chance to sit with him and talk about all those really cool stories.
Yes, thank you so much. He's, you know, so gracious. You could tell he, you know, more than happy to sit and chat with us. And it was really nice.
Yeah. I really enjoyed hearing all the first-hand accounts of a lot of the attractions that, you know, we absolutely love.
Oh, yeah. And we didn't even get to everything. There's so
no,
much
there was
more to
so
cover.
Much other stuff.
He worked on, I know we really want to talk about how he worked on Knott's Berry Tales.
Yep.
So
Astroworld.
Yeah. So I feel like we're going to be chatting with him again soon.
I would hope so.
Yeah, hopefully.
He's very easy to talk to.
Yes.
So I hope everybody really, really enjoyed this season premiere of the Theme Park Duo podcast with an interview with Rolly Crump. If you did, please do us a favor. Head on over to iTunes and leave us a 5-star written review. It's always very helpful for us. It raises us up in the standings and it makes it easier for everyone to find us and enjoy us like you are right now. And if you want to look us up on the social medias, as the kids say these days.
Do they?
Social medias. That's my kid voice.
Going through puberty voice?
No. I feel funny. If you want to look us up on social media, make sure you head over to Facebook, Instagram, Twitter. There's one more. And YouTube. There you go. I knew there was only one more. All you have to do is search Theme Park Duo, and you will be able to find us.
Uh-huh.
And if you want to reach us, if you want to contact us about anything, if you think there's something about the show that can be improved, there's something about the show that you love, a topic you want to hear, anything at all, make sure you email us at
themeparkduo@gmail.com.
As always, guys, thank you so much for listening. This is the only, hopefully, one of many great episodes for season 3. I know that we have a list of topics that we want to get to.
We sure do.
Event coverage. You know, we always get very busy during the haunt season and many of things like that.
Uh-huh.
So, very much excited to bring you guys, the audience and fans of the show, exactly what you want to hear. So, thank you again for listening to this season premiere. And as always, there's always a great, big, beautiful tomorrow. See ya!
Thanks for riding with the Theme Park Duo. Make sure to gather all your belongings before the end of the podcast. Bye-bye.